officially call the meeting of the Rules Committee, Senate Rules Committee, to order. Secretary Brewer, could you just do a review of our last meeting?
Yes, Mr. Chair. At the last meeting, there was discussion as to how to proceed. There was a motion made by Senator Flory, which generally would have introduced a resolution or a motion that said the Senate, in very concise terms, would take up the McAllister issue after the criminal trials, criminal procedures were completed. There was some debate at that time, and there was, I was asked to draft up two different forms of resolutions. Those went through various iterations, and what you have before you is a draft I was requested by Senator Baruth, which would, and possibly others, have a suspension of Senator McAllister. At the time that we met, the original version was probably going to be some form of expulsion. Subsequent to that, it is transformed into a potential suspension with lots of work by both our office and by Ledge Council, including Betsy Rass, to find out background on suspensions and the feasibility of suspensions and where they've been used in the past. And the second resolution and motion paper in front of you is one that with Senator Flory, which would establish a new Senate rule put in as a Rule 102, that when there were criminal charges against the senator, there would be a special committee established, and then that committee would meet, and during the time period that the charges were pending, or they would await taking formal action until the pending criminal charges were resolved.
Okay, so what I'd like to do prior to us going in and discussing the specific resolutions, could you tell us, you mentioned that you've been meeting with Betsy Rass from Ledge Council to discuss the issues of whether it be expulsion, suspension, what that would mean, whether it's had any other history throughout the country in any other bodies. Can you kind of just give us a little quick rundown of how that went?
Yes, Senator. Generally, there are four courses that the Senate could follow. There are some agreements, but there are generally four courses. One of them is you have the power to expel. You have the power to take either no action, you have the power sort of to delay action, and then you have gradients in between. The Constitution provides that you have the power to expel. That doesn't mean that that's your only power in disciplining various Senate members. Looking through other sources, our Mason's rules, other parliamentary sources, you have an ability to sanction, suspend, do intermediate penalties for different types of behavior that a legislator or senator could take. More directly on, I think your question was that as part of this gradients of potential discipline, one of them is suspension. I was asked to potentially look into that. I didn't have much familiarity as it being used elsewhere in the country, to be honest. And so the way I approach these things is to try to find where there is some precedent or some other place that's addressed the issue. And most recently, through some research, most recently, California in 2014 suspended three senators, all at the same time, in the same resolution. And I can give you much more background on that if you want, but that's sort of where I started. I wanted to know more about the process to make sure that any of the alternatives you may pursue have some sort of foundational and parliamentary precedent somewhere. And so I spent some time actually on the telephone with a couple members of the California Senate Secretary's Office, exploring how they went about the process and what they did. And that is, I guess, an abbreviated version of the background for what the version in front of you on suspension. It's a bit different process than expulsion because it's not permanent.
And the expulsion aspect, as I mentioned in that meeting, many of us had concerns as to if expulsion was in fact sought, that it could potentially interfere with the any current criminal action that's pending. So if you could just review, if it was an expulsion, what would that require us to do under our rules if that was being sought?
It's pretty clear, and I think there's general agreement with anyone I've talked to, both here in this building and elsewhere, that if you are doing an expulsion because of its permanent nature, there is established case law and precedent that you have to follow. And that precedent would require a hearing, some minimal, I hate to use the term due process because it's sort of loaded. It's not the same as a criminal due process, but there is due process.
Administrative due process.
It's just a little different form. But there are some minimums. You have to give a notice. You have to have a hearing. You have to have a foundation. You probably, depending on which case law you look at, you probably have to have anyone who's having the investigation done the right to go and ask questions, maybe be represented by a lawyer, probably have to be given the opportunity to. The question then becomes who pays for the lawyer. There's just a lot of process that's out there. And each of the different cases have addressed it slightly different. So it's not as if it's uniform. It's because, as I've seen, some require less and some require more. But it is, from at least my opinion, that if you go through an expulsion hearing, there would need to be formal charges. Well, you could potentially start off with an investigation, and then formal charges would have to be brought, and then the charges would have to be investigated, and there's a whole series of steps that would need to be accomplished to go through a full expulsion. A suspension, given that it's a little bit, it is a bit different, and it's not permanent, there are different sort of requirements. It doesn't appear by looking through precedent and talking to California that in that sense you need to do a full hearing. Now, it's a little bit less black and white or clear than the expulsion. But the precedent that I was able to find was that it's not, at this point, no one has gone through the full hearing process to do a suspension. And no one's challenged it to say that you have to do it. But if one wanted to try to look at gradients, I do not believe that you would need to do a full hearing, full due process, if you would, in the Senate, decided to suspend for a day. Because you have the power to suspend for a day for misbehavior, certain types of misbehavior. If you and the Senate in their duties thought that was the appropriate sanction, I do not believe you need to go through a full hearing due process. And similarly, you would need to do one if you were doing an indefinite suspension, because that's nothing more than an expulsion. And that is one of the reasons, through my research and speaking quite a bit with California, the language you have before you is nearly identical to their language. And that's why there's an end when it talks about dismissal. If the trial occurs and the charges are dismissed, well, not guilty, they're just dismissed by the state, the suspension is immediately revoked. And that sense, it's sort of like a trigger, it's not indefinite. And that's the language that California used. And once again, they were not challenged. They understood that there might be a challenge, but they felt, at least in my opinion from conversations, that they didn't think there would be one and they didn't think it would be successful. That doesn't mean there couldn't be a challenge.
So again, just to, I want to make sure of this, is because the concern that a lot of us have, again, goes back to the pending criminal case, which obviously the defendant is absolutely guaranteed his rights under the Constitution. Also, the state, we're concerned about interfering with the state's ability to prosecute this case, whether it be due to contact with witnesses or requesting law enforcement to express all of their specific investigation. So I want to make sure.
I apologize. Because no, I think that was more targeted your question. I think I digressed out a little ways. So I'm sorry I didn't cover it directly the first time. If you were going to do a full hearing, you need to bring in witnesses, at least in my opinion. Now, you get a lawyer, you're going to get numerous lawyers, you get different opinions, but I would be hesitant to have the Senate do a hearing based on affidavits. And so in that sense, I think you need to have people come in and testify. And you, Senator, you mentioned at least two different groups that would probably need to at least be called. There may be other groups, but one of them is the police and one of them is the alleged victims. And if they come in and testify, there is a potential for an impact on any trial. And I can't, without knowing, hindsight's 20/20, foresight's not necessarily, and so in that sense, without knowing exactly what we testify to, I can't tell you who would definitely affect the criminal charge, but there is a risk that as those questions were asked, it could have an impact. And indeed, the other side of that coin is there might be a hesitation to provide information to the Senate with the criminal charges by some of the people you might have to request to come in and testify. And I haven't been able to sort out all of your options, we're not there yet, as to what you would do if people came in and politely declined to provide information because of the pending criminal charge. And that may create additional issues if you start a process. So the very concise answer would be there is a potential that it could impact a criminal trial because you would have to go and have a much more elaborate hearing and bring in witnesses.
Okay. Pat, and then we'll go down so if you have any questions for John.
I have a question from the other side of it, not on the rights of the people represented by the senator. And I know I've heard from some and I understand they've contacted the State House. And in looking up the Constitution and the oath of office we take, which is part of the Constitution, it says, let's see, in section 16, that, let me go back, we will not consent to any act or thing, whatever, that shall have a tendency to lessen or abridge their, referring back to the constituents, rights and privileges as declared by the Constitution. So I guess my concern and my question is if we do a suspension, then we have a prolonged period of time that the residents in that area are being denied their constitutional right to fair representation. And as the court declared in Buckley, if anyone brings it up, that the individual's right to is unconstitutionally impaired when its weight is in a substantial fashion diluted. And then it goes on to other things. So one of my concerns is if we go ahead and vote to suspend, and either the senator fights it, or the constituents fight it, where are we then? And that's, yeah, it's a rotten situation to be in right now. I wish it had never happened. I wish the trial were over. But, you know, we got to play with the cards that are dealt us.
You're asking two separate areas.
Yeah.
And I'm going to take the challenge by Senator McAllister first, because I think it's slightly easier.
Mm-hmm. I agree.
If Senator McAllister is suspended and not expelled, depending on, once again, if you're doing it indefinitely, that's a problem. It's like a, if you're doing it for a limited one-day period, I think that the chances of the challenge being successful are very minimal. Anything can, as you know, Senator, anything can happen in the court of law. And so sometimes it's, and nothing's as black and white as maybe it used to be long ago. And so there's lots of gray as to how successful a challenge would be.
In between one day and indefinite.
Now, I don't mean to be, I think the practical side of it is, if this is looked at as a suspension for the body, then a challenge to a suspension leaves you with still, whether that's successful or unsuccessful or just pending, now get you back to what your other options are. And your other options, the nice thing about a resolution on a suspension is it can be modified, changed. You know, lots could occur in the next month or two or 5 months. It's not as if it's permanent, so you can always revisit it. The other thing you can always revisit is if it turns out that the senator wants a full hearing in the Senate chamber, you can start expulsion hearing. Now, as the other senator mentioned, that may create an issue with the trial, but the fallback position is sometimes watch what you ask for, because you may get something different that you don't like even as much. And so one can challenge lots of things, and there's lots of different ways of approaching legal issues. But I believe that in as long as there's a definitive trigger, it should be okay in the court.
Okay. Constituents?
Which means that with that long answer, I told you that was the shorter and the easier one. So a couple things on that. I believe or explored some of it. I didn't explore it through the constitutional provisions. I'm slightly familiar with what you cited, including Baker, Buckley. And so I am, some of that is, I haven't explored as much yet, but I will tell you what I have explored. So with California, I discussed that with them. It was not challenged out there. There was some questions about it. There was some media attention to it. Indeed, in that one, it was kind of unique. One of them was, this was late March, early April when they were suspended. One of them actually was convicted maybe October, late September. They immediately resigned. California has term limits, and so the other two termed out that November. So how long is that when they're using the same language? So I don't know whether it has to be a 2 month. But
they also don't have this in their constitution.
Right. The real issue is if one looks at this and believes what one reads, which you always have to keep with a grain of salt, the trial is scheduled for February. And that's the best information I have currently. And that, if it's a suspension, one can at least look at it as a 6 to 8 week suspension. You all, as the Senate, can readdress it at any time. If the trial doesn't occur in February, it's nice, the beauty of a resolution. And when I have looked at it sort of that way, there have been senators missing for long periods of time. At least two that I'm familiar with in the last 5 to 10 years. I don't really want to get into it, but there's been at least two. And given the term way this resolution is drafted, if the trial occurs in February, then that's no different than some of the other times that senators have been missing. Once again, I'm assuming that the response is, well, nobody challenged it, but it's the same length of time.
I guess, John, people that were missing were missing for their own reasons, health or reasons like that. It wasn't that they were suspended and prohibited from acting under their title.
But the two parts would be, one is the citizens are in no different position, mm-hmm. and it's because the senator could come back, they don't have anybody on the floor to vote, well, that senator's out. So it's from the constituents, at least the way I look at it, it's sort of the same. Secondly, under Mason's rule, you clearly have the ability to suspend for non-attendance. And that's Mason's mentions the term suspension as a punishment for not being here. And so, in that sense, not that it was addressed at the time, but you would have had the power to suspend then. Suspension is also mentioned in some other parliamentary law. There's Hughes and there's Cushing's, and that's kind of where California went to look mm-hmm. for support, because they also use Mason's. So I think that there is a danger if you made it indefinite, where that line is and where it would be successful. I am not a constitutional lawyer. And so when the challenge comes, it's going to be, is the court going to think that this is an appropriate legislative function and stay out of it? And the more my advice and thought is, the more well-defined the suspension and if there's a trigger, the safer you are if you go down that road.
Joe?
I don't have any questions for the Secretary.
I think you just answered my question, John. Let's play out scenarios. As I understand it, if the suspension resolution was advanced, your understanding is that there would not necessarily be a hearing.
Joe, I'm sorry. I'm having trouble hearing you, and I actually want to hear you.
We won't address that.
That's a new change for me. I want to glorify the moment. But if, in fact, the suspension resolution goes forward, the chances of a hearing are decreased. Am I reading that? In comparison to an expulsion.
The chances that you don't, the precedent is that if you are doing a suspension, you don't have to go through a full-blown hearing process in the Senate.
Okay.
If I understand that
answers that question.
But let me just give you a little background. It's not like there's a whole slew of cases out there. And so when I'm giving you an answer, I want to make sure that I give you the full package on this. I talked to California for a long time. They believed that they didn't have to, and because it was a disciplinary sort of function and that it was within their power. Did they think that there was no chance it'd be challenged? Well, in their instance, I believe they were slightly worried, but at that time, the quotes in the newspaper from the senators' attorneys were saying that we're happy. And so there didn't look like there was going to be a challenge. And so the downside of holding very little hearings is if the senator decides to challenge it, it gives them an argument. Now, whether or not it's one that's successful, as you know, Senator, it's hard to predict, but the precedent would be it's not required. I have not found any place out there where somebody held somewhere that a hearing was required for a suspension. I haven't found it.
Okay. Thanks.
Great.
No, I'm fine.
Okay. One last question, then we'll go to the individual presentation of the resolutions. And this goes to the fact that there One, of course, calls for suspension, the other one calls for the commission, or the formation of a commission or a committee to look at this. What is your view? Are these mutually exclusive, these two?
I haven't been asked that. The rule.
Do you want to see them join?
That's okay. Thank you, though, Senator.
I guess I should have shown you the evidence.
No, I mean, you know, I suppose they're not mutual. Technically, the Senate could pass them sequentially and still be okay. Meaning, the Senate, I don't want to play logic games with you, but if you wanted to say whether you there's under no circumstances could you pass them both, I think you could pass the one of Senator Baruth first and then pass the one for Senator Flory second, because you've already taken the action with Senator Baruth to suspend them, and then if you don't change the rules till after that's done, then it doesn't apply to the first resolution.
Does that because I want to make sure that we're very clear about.
Although. And correct me if I'm wrong, but once we got to the floor, if Senator Flory's was passed first, that would preclude the passage on the floor of my resolution.
Senator, I mean, the real trigger issue is it would make it difficult but not impossible, and secondly, it could make it very, very messy. I'm going to give you two scenarios that come to mind first. First time I've been asked this question also. The first scenario is that even if a new rule is added, if the remainder of the senator wanted to suspend the rules, they could do the second one. If a new rule is added, mm-hmm. I forget the number, 102, I think it is, and then the second one was brought up and it was raised to point of order that violates the Senate rules, I think you could suspend rule 102 and take up the resolution. Mm-hmm. And so that's the more difficult path. The more interesting path, and one that I recommend against, because in this current job, chaos is not my goal, is that your rules can be amended by a majority. And so, you know, you kind of get in this hopscotching thing that if the rule 102 is enacted and it's just 16 that don't like it and don't want to apply it, you could re-amend the rules, and then it gets really messy and ugly. But a majority, as I told, I think every senator on this panel, in the end, the majority rules in the Vermont Senate, if you don't mind getting your hands real dirty, not that you should be getting them fiercely.
Dirty is a pejorative sense
yes.
here. I don't think that's what you mean.
Yeah, but I mean, it's just like, you're going to have, it's going to be messy. And so that's one of the reasons that
I take the point, and I appreciate the clarification. I suppose I meant under normal order. It seems as one of the practical effects of Senator Flory's, which she'll describe in a minute, says if criminal charges pending, the committee shall suspend further activities and not meet again until the charge is done. So unless we did some extraordinary maneuvering, I hear you saying, that would preclude.
You know, interesting, you know, I have to think about this. So I think, I don't know if I have an answer, but here's what I think. I mean, you as the Senate can have a rule, and I don't know whether that fully binds an expulsion motion or a different disciplinary matter. And so you're asking a question I'm not sure I understood as deep as it may really be. If you have a rule that sets up process when there's a criminal charge, that's the default process. And now all of a sudden the Senate decides we want to do some kind of discipline. Not expulsion, but basically says we want to suspend for a day. I have to think about whether or not that violates the rule, because you're not gonna have to have an investigation for a suspension. Mm-hmm. I just hadn't thought, your question is deeper than I originally thought. And so I'm not sure they're inconsistent.
Or maybe,
I don't want to take this side either way, Senator.
Or maybe shallower. And what I mean by that is, I said, may not be deeper, my question, it may be closer to the surface, because what I think I'm talking about is the intent of the two resolutions, not necessarily the depth of power the Senate has to undo rules that are passed. Yep. So my question is probably better reserved for our discussion of the actual resolution.
I just hadn't really thought, I mean, I think by doing a rule, you're not necessarily depriving your chamber of having certain inherent powers. And if this, the way that I think it's currently drafted, maybe if there's charges and you're going to investigate for those charges, I think there may be other types of sanctions or discipline you might be able to take outside of that. But I have to think about that. And I don't know whether that includes a suspension. I honestly haven't put thought into it.
Now I'm going to have one other procedural issue just to make sure, because what I would like to do is to have these presented and we'll discuss them both, but I do not want the order in which I take them to be given for any specific weight to be given as to which would be presented first on the floor. So does everyone agree with that?
Mm-hmm. Joe?
We,
yep.
Okay. We could pass both, but on the floor, what we passed first today might be second.
Correct.
On the floor, right?
Right. So okay. I just don't want to have any, again,
yep.
We're not looking at it.
Yep.
We don't want to race to the...
to the order. Yeah.
Yeah. Do you see what I'm saying, John? Also, if we're filing these resolutions have to be filed. That's the other, kind of the backup to this question, is if the resolution is filed, if one is filed before the other,
Well, interestingly, I don't know what kind of version they're going to come out of the committee. So the, if it's a committee resolution, then it's coming out of the committee. If it's introduced by an individual, right, this rules committee. So there's a couple different tracks these could follow. Usually, resolutions are slightly different than bills. You all have recently gone through the bill process, had a deadline, had to come in the end. You give the okay to ledge counsel, they do some proofing, they send it to the printer, and it's not, our office isn't really too involved until we receive them back. They bring them up, they come back, they go online. They're already online if you're looking, senators. Resolution's a bit different. Depending on what kind of resolution it is, there's a little bit different path. Frequently, the typical path is that they're drafted in ledge council, they're brought up sort of in a pre-form, and then we put them in the final form, we number them, we put them together. So there's a bit of a distinction in the two different processes. Mm-hmm. So if it's a committee resolution, if there's sort of one resolution that comes out of this committee, probably there's two or three little resolutions we have to do that are joint resolutions. Week in adjournment, blah, blah, blah. But this would be the first sort of new stuff that would be introduced.
Well, let me stop you, because I know where you're going, but that's not where I'm asking. What I really want to get at is we have two resolutions that are not mutually exclusive. And the fact is that there is a possibility that we could pass both of these resolutions through this body today.
You could pass through the committee, they'd be introduced. Yes, and if you took them up, I'm fairly confident, if you took them up, the suspension and then the rule change, they're not inconsistent. The other way, I have to put some more thought into it. I just want to be, I don't want to be misunderstood.
We're just trying to make you earn your keep. We saw the 7 days article today. And
sure.
How much money you're
earning. I hear you saying that they're not mutually exclusive, and I believe that in a intellectual and absolute sense, but the thrust of the two resolutions are headed in the opposite direction. One indicating that the Senate should hold off on action, the other providing a vehicle for the Senate to take action. So I wouldn't want there to be confusion that somehow these are in parallel with one another if they're not mutually exclusive.
Well, I don't it's up to you to decide how you want to proceed. I think you could potentially, at least procedurally, pass them both. The impression that it gives is beyond my pay grade, so to speak, but it wouldn't violate any rules depending on which sequence you use. The only, I have, what I'm gathering is you may, there's distinctions the way that these are introduced. And I just want to, I guess I need to address this. So if this committee decides to support both of these resolutions, they're both going to come out of the committee and they will go on, there's three options, I don't want to get too far, but it'll probably go on for action the following day. There's three different options, we can talk about that. The difference, the distinction would be if this committee supports one and then an individual senator introduces one, that one that the individual senator introduces, my recommendation will probably be to refer that to a committee.
I'm sorry, which one?
Refer to it. I'm not saying which one. I'm just saying if both of these resolutions come out of this committee, it's sponsored by the Senate Rules Committee, they're going to get numbers and they're going to be read on the floor, and then there's three different ways we kind of go through the process. They're going to be acted on. Unless the Senate decides to refer, the overall body can vote by a majority to refer it to a committee and do whatever they please with it. The second option is only one is supported by the committee, and then the other is introduced by a senator individually, or a group of senators. If that occurs, the one that's supported by the committee will get a number, will go through that process of being on the floor, unless the Senate decides to refer it. The second one that's introduced by an individual committee, my recommendation to the presiding officer will be that that's referred to a committee.
Mm-hmm. So
that makes a difference to you.
Although, am I correct that if one came from the Rules Committee and it reached the floor, a senator could produce a substitute?
Yes. Now, maybe I'm not getting once again as deep as you are.
In other words, without going through the committee process.
Right. So that's it's a different issue. And you're asking whether or not these two are mutually exclusive. Maybe that's the question I missed. If one of these is on the floor, I'm not sure the other one is germane to it.
Right.
Okay, if that's your question. I mean, either way, if Senator Flores is supported by the committee and that's on the floor, that is a rule change. And if someone then decided to substitute a suspension of Senator McAllister for the rule change, I'm not sure that's germane. And just like if this committee supports a suspension of Senator McAllister and Senator Flory decides to then go and move for a rule change as a substitute, I don't think it's germane.
The final before we go to Representative Flory, or Secretary Flory, how's that? I give you the motion. Senator Flory. Is that... If we go as a committee and we're going to support the suspension resolution, that's what comes out. If any senator wants to subsequently change the rules as far as how the procedure for such an action would take place in the future, they can then introduce a bill or what once were.
Correct, and they could introduce an amendment or a substitution that would be germane. I mean, there are some other language that could make.
Okay. Mm-hmm. If we could, Peg, why don't you go ahead and explain yours?
Yep. Thank you. I did this for a couple of reasons. Continue to offer it for a variety of different reasons. One, the idea of having to go through an expulsion just struck me as against the very grain of what we believe in, and that's the presumption of innocence. It worried me that by doing that, we would either be jeopardizing the prosecution's ability to prosecute, or the defense ability to properly defend. However, to ignore the fact that there is something going on in the Senate also raised some concerns. The difficulty for me is we have nothing in our rules. We have nothing in the law that addresses this. And it isn't, frankly, just in our chamber. We have it with all sorts of elected officials. When I really got thinking about it, it occurred to me we've had a variety of elected municipal officials charged with crimes of embezzlement, other things that nobody can take any action on, because when someone is elected, the power belongs to their constituents, and we don't have a right of recall as constituents. So what I tried to do was address it so that when someone is charged with a felony, we immediately form a committee. And I tried to model this a little bit as a cross between our Child Protection Committee that the Senate formed last year and the House ethics rules, because they did pass an ethics policy and rules. I'm not sure I like all of them, but one of them specifically says that if a representative is charged with a crime, the ethics panel shall have no jurisdiction until that's adjudicated. What this does is it changes our rules to say we create the committee. However, the committee has no authority to take any action until entry of judgment of the charge. Not an appeal period. Once a verdict is rendered or a plea is entered into, the committee could take action. And it is not necessarily tied to a guilty or innocent verdict. The person could be found, and this is not specific to Senator McAllister. This is for any of us in the future. The person could be found not guilty. The committee still has to meet and decide whether, in fact, any disciplinary action might be considered. Because you might be found not guilty of criminal activity, but the committee may still feel that the behavior was such that it cast the Senate on a bad light or anything else and might want to take action. So that's what this is designed to do, to leave the authority open once a verdict is entered, but to not interfere with the criminal process and still protect the rights of the accused and the rights of the constituents of the accused. And that's why I offered
that. I have one question quickly. You mentioned felony, because this what I see is one charged with a crime, which obviously does not necessarily
mean felony. It was supposed to say felony.
And I guess the other thing, too, is that there are many levels of felonies, obviously.
I understand.
So are we just talking about any felony here?
Yes, my intent was felony, and I thought we had changed that to felony. I'm sorry. Because quite frankly, if it's a embezzlement, you probably still want to take a look at it if it's a senator. And the senator, he or she, has been charged with it. I don't think it necessarily has to be the listed crimes. I think it could be anything.
John, if I may. So Senator Frey, I believe, mentioned that the House had passed a rule indicating that they didn't have jurisdiction if criminal charges were pending. And I'll ask Secretary Bloomer if I might, because I don't know if I have this right. Am I right that that was the ethics panel's internal mm-hmm. regulation? The House did not pass that.
Right.
Okay. And I wouldn't speculate about the other body, but I believe one of the reasons for that could possibly be that they might not be able to pass that through the other body, because what it involves is the body.
But you weren't going to speculate.
Well, I said it may be. I think what it involves is, in this case, the Senate unilaterally disempowering itself in all future cases, as well as this case, if there are felony charges pending. So that's my main reason for opposing this. And I think there are two parts of it. The first is the creation of a committee. And in other words, it has moved to us. And then if we were to create another committee, I think we're moving down the wrong road. I think we need to provide leadership on this issue and on this particular question, the question of Senator McAllister. So to that question, which I believe is the real reason we're here today, if you look in the middle, the sentence, the special committee shall meet within 2 legislative days after being appointed, and here's the crucial language, if the criminal charge is pending, shall suspend all further activities and shall not meet again until the entry of judgment as to the charge. So, and again, if I'm wrong on any of this, please correct me, but if we pass this, and let's say we didn't pass the suspension resolution, if we just passed this and the Senate concurred, we would be prevented from acting in Senator McAllister's case. I believe that's exactly the reverse of what this committee, the Rules Committee, should be doing. I think we should act in this case. We certainly shouldn't refuse to act and then refuse to act in every case in the future. So I can't support this, although I appreciate the sentiment that brought it forward.
You're partially correct.
Yep.
This says the Senate will not be judge and jury. The Senate will wait until the judge and jury gives a decision, and then we'll take action, not necessarily in conformance with the judge and jury, but...
The only thing I would say in response is we are set up as a different branch of government from the judiciary. We're supposed to regulate ourselves, so I don't think we're supposed to be judge and jury, but I do believe we're supposed to regulate our own members.
My question would be, once the court has decided this committee, why is the committee still involved once the court has decided innocence or guilt? And here it says it comes back to the committee. Shouldn't it be ended with a court's decision?
I don't think so, because in my mind, as I said, if the person is found not guilty, there may have been evidence or admissions of something that the Senate still believes it is necessary for the Senate to take action on. And that's why I put it in. If the person is found guilty, my guess is that the committee would take very quick action based on the fact that there was a finding of guilt. But if there was a finding of not guilty, the committee still could, or the committee could say, we have nothing to do and disband. It would be their choice.
Here's my concern with it, and then I'm sorry, I'm going to go to Senator Benning. And let's just take the current situation off the table for a second.
That's
let's
what I've been
trying. Let's talk about any issue. Is the fact that I see this as we're dealing with two specifically different issues and different avenues. You have the criminal courts. If there's a criminal, crime charge, you have the criminal charge. You have the criminal courts where there is a burden of proof of beyond a reasonable doubt,
mm-hmm.
and there are certain, many not just constitutional, but also procedural protections afforded to the defendants in those cases. We are not a, we, the Senate, are not a court of law that judges the criminal actions or criminal activity. I think what we are is a body, a legislative body, that makes a decision that whether a senator who is currently sitting, whether they have either breached the oath of office which they took, or if they, if their actions have subjected them to being, not to be able to perform their duties as a senator. And there, the burden of proof is not a beyond reasonable doubt. There's not, we have a decision to make, and I think it's authorized in the rules and in the Constitution for us to provide disciplinary action, as does, you know, pretty much anything else. If you have, let's say, the teachers, or if there's a teacher who commits a crime, or is allegations that there might have been some activity with them, with a student, or with something even outside of that, you know, they clearly, you know, can be suspended pending the outcome of a trial. I think what we're saying that this resolution, the suspension resolution, is basically saying is that we feel that activity, if we went on and continued this precedent once, is that the activity of a senator rose to that level of where we believe that person should be temporarily suspended from their duties as a senator. So I that's the part that concerns me about your resolution, Peg, because I think it's bringing us into a totally different venue.
Well, actually, I think what you just said is why I've put in answer to Senator Mazza's question, that once there is an adjudication, once there's a verdict, the committee then needs to decide, even though it didn't rise to a criminal level, does the behavior rise to a level that the Senate should take action on? Because you're right, there's different levels of proof, there's different expectations, all of that.
What if there was a case that involved one senator doing something, not necessarily of a sexual nature, but there's doing something assaultive or something to another senator? Mm-hmm. Under your situation, and if they were charged criminally, they could not, we could not act. Whereas if it was somebody, let's just say that someone came in drunken one day and decides he's going to punch out senators.
Mm-hmm.
If under your rule and regulation, we would not, under this, we would not have an ability to suspend that person to do anything to that individual who we may think might be pose a danger to fellow senators or other people in the building.
My guess is if that person came in and pounded me and I went to the police, that person would have been arrested. And if that person were, in fact, a danger to society, that's one of the few reasons that we can not issue bail. So that person would not be out coming to assault me again. Or I would have the protective orders in. What we're talking about in the instant case is the person is out on bail, has no conditions of release prohibiting them from associating with the general public, none of those usual and customary conditions of release that you would put in place for someone that you believed was a danger to the general public in place. If you in fact had someone that came in and assaulted, you had a senator that came in and assaulted one of us, my strong belief is they would be arrested, they would have conditions of release that would include it. It may say they can't come in here, can't be around me. Now, that would bring us to the other problem of the constitutional protections of the constituents. You know, we're talking a whole lot of what ifs. And it's, as Secretary Bloomer said, I found four different states where they've tried suspensions or expulsions. They were not challenged. So we're in uncharted territory. We don't know what's going to happen. All of us realize that. I tried to put out something that I thought protected the criminal process with the least amount of risk to all involved, that would give the public the reassurance that we are taking this matter seriously, but we are also taking the constitutional rights of the prosecution and defendant seriously.
Well, without debating the bail issue, I'll go to Joe.
Yeah.
Peg, can I first ask you a question? The language says the entry of judgment as to the charge as being the triggering mechanism for when a committee would reconvene.
Yes.
For whatever reason, if there was a stay pending appeal of that entry of judgment, are you asking that the committee not do anything until the appeal is over as well?
No, that's why we specifically put entry of judgment as to the charge. Did not get into the appeal.
What I'm asking is, if for whatever reason the court stayed entry of judgment pending appeal, is it your intention to have the committee reconvene only after the appeal is heard?
My intent was upon entry of judgment, and if you want to question the way it's written, I'll refer it to either Ledge Counsel or Secretary Bloomer, both of whom worked on drafting it.
Okay. Secretary Bloomer, can I ask you that question? Do you read this, if the court for whatever reason stayed entry of judgment pending appeal, are we literally with this language saying the committee cannot reconvene until after the appeal is resolved?
I'm going to give you two answers, Senator.
I would only expect, since there are four attorneys around the table, that we do have six different
opinions. So my first answer to you is, it would foreclose, if the entry of judgment is, if the court delays entry of judgment, then this, you can't take any action until that's relieved by the court. I mean, you could get into a bigger argument over what's the difference between the legislature, can they interfere with judiciary? You might be able to do it, but a clear interpretation or straightforward interpretation would be you'd probably have to wait. The second answer is, I'm not trying to pass the buck, but this was not part of the language I did. So I don't have any intent as to what the intent was, but my reading of this would be that if there was a stay, you'd have to wait. But I'm not sure what the intent was.
Okay. Can I ask who actually drafted that?
The stage? Version I got had Luke Martin.
I drafted it.
Luke, can I ask you the same question? Would it be your interpretation with this language that if...
Joe, why don't you come on up real quick, just because we're trying to be extra formal here today.
Luke Marland, Director of Ledge Counsel.
Luke, I understand that you're the draftsperson of this particular phrase, and I'm speaking specifically about the phrase that reads, the special committee shall meet within 2 legislative days after being appointed, and if the criminal charge is pending, shall suspend all further activities and shall not meet again until the entry of judgment as to the charge. Am I correct in assuming that you drafted that language?
Yes, you are, Chair.
Am I safe in assuming that with that language, in your opinion, that if there was, for whatever reason, a stay of judgment pending appeal, that this committee could not reconvene until after the appeal had been resolved?
Not necessarily. The intent was to ensure that after a trial, this special committee could meet and take whatever action it deems appropriate, and it did not have to wait for the appellate process to be resolved. The specific question that you're asking, Senator, was not something that I discussed with the Senator sponsoring this resolution. The language used, that phrase used, is from Vermont statutes, so it's meant to reflect phrasing that is used, for example, in Title 13 and in other contexts. this is not an issue that we discussed with sponsor, so I'd have to look into it. I know the intent of the sponsor, please correct me if I'm wrong, was once there's a verdict at trial, the trial's resolved, as to any of the charges, if there's multiple charges, then the special committee could meet and take action, did not have to wait for appeal. If there was a verdict, but the entry judgment was stayed, I don't know what the sponsor's intent was. I can't answer if that would mean that the special committee could not meet. We might have to massage this language if the committee wishes to do so.
You would agree with me, I take it, that if we left the language as is and passed this resolution, that it would provide an argument at least to someone affected, that if there's an appeal and the entry of judgment hasn't been entered yet, that they have the right to have that appeal process play out.
Yes, I agree with what you just said.
Thank you. That was the only question that I had. I do have a position, and I don't know when you want to take a position.
Why don't we, is there any further questions for Peg or for John or for Luke? Seeing them, Peg, do you want to, and before we vote on this, what I'd like to do is, and Norm is here, and just to offer you, Norm, and a time if you want to make any statement, that's up to you. You don't have to. I would say we don't. I don't think any of us want to hear anything about the allegations or about any of the charges. But at some point, I think before we actually vote on this, I would like to give Norm an opportunity to respond.
John, would it be more appropriate to have that on
yes,
the suspension?
Yes, afterwards. I think I'm...
Because I hear Peg saying that she doesn't necessarily mean this to speak to Norm's case.
And if I can just ask procedurally, my understanding is my motion is on the floor since I made it at the last rules meeting and we tabled it until it could get reduced to writing. Am I right? So
well, yeah,
that's what's taken right. up here first. It may not be taken up on the floor first.
Correct, but what I'm getting at is what I think would be preferable here, and you will is if we already have discussed yours, we want to have various opinions have that be voiced on that, then here, before we vote on it, then here the suspension, and then go back to the voting in order to give Norm an opportunity to speak before an actual vote is taken. That's what I'd like to do.
Okay.
Was that an objection?
I'll go ahead. Thank you. So this is the one sentence resolution that I believe you have. To give it a bit of context, at our last Rules Committee meeting, we considered two options. One was expulsion, and the other was a form of having the Senate express the desire not to act where criminal charges were pending. And in that sense, we were of two minds. I will say that I was substantially persuaded by some of the arguments against expulsion, particularly the Senate President Pro Tem's argument that it could impact the ongoing criminal trial. And so what I set out to do was try to find a middle ground between the Senate expressing a desire and a permanent rule to not act in such cases and expulsion. And so what that led me to was suspension. And having looked at the California process and having studied it to a certain extent, it seems to me what happened in that process was their body moved more and more towards simplicity. So there were three separate resolutions that went into their rules committee. They were longer, they had whereas clauses. Their rules committee, in what I think was a very wise move, whittled it all down to one resolution of one sentence repeated for each of the three defendants. Now, why is that wise? I think in this case, and people have used different adjectives to describe it, it's muddled, it's confusing, it's dicey, it's a million different not good things. And I think to the extent that the Rules Committee can serve the function of clarifying and leading, regulating and organizing the body, then we do the work we were set up to do. So, what this says is one sentence, and I will just read it. that the sentence hereby, that the Senate hereby suspends Senator Norman H. McAllister from exercising any of the powers of his office as a member of the Senate until all criminal proceedings currently pending against him have been dismissed. Now, my questions, to go back to Secretary Bloomer's presentation, my questions were, first, do we have the power to do this? It seemed that, yes, we did. My belief is, if we have the power to do it, then that answers Senator Flory's question about constituents. Do they have a challenge to our suspension? If we have the power to do it, then I believe that that question is answered. You'll notice here also that it says, from exercising any of the powers of his office. In California, they were worried about a suspended senator being paid during their suspension. They determined that constitutionally they could not stop a senator's pay, and so they put in a parallel piece of legislation to change that constitutional provision to allow for unpaid suspension. But as you know, changing the Constitution in any state is an extremely long, arduous process. So for the sake of simplicity, I have not introduced parallel wording to try to change that provision. So the upshot here is that were this committee to pass this language, were the Senate to concur with that, Senator McAllister would be suspended pending the charges against him being dismissed, and he would continue to be paid during that time. He would not be allowed expenses because he would not be acting in his capacity as a senator during that time. Now, very briefly, let me just speak to the reason why I think this is crucial that the Senate act on this. I won't get into the substance of affidavits that have come out or any of that. I'd like to limit what I say to the level of the charges themselves. So it is not in dispute that Senator McAllister has been charged with multiple counts of felony sexual assault. It is also not in dispute that one of those alleged victims served as his state house intern. That being the case, it seems to me that the Senate is compelled to act, and for several reasons. First, we stand in loco parentis to the classes of pages that come through our doors every session. We have multiple classes of pages. I believe they're eighth grade pages. We also have a series of state house staff who are, by definition, in a subsidiary deferential role to senators. The third reason is, in our permanent sexual harassment rules, one of the things the Senate declared when we adopted those is that above all else, we were determined to maintain a workplace free from anxiety or fear with regard to sexual harassment or misconduct. It's my belief that having a senator sit and vote and receive that deferential treatment from people in a power position beneath him with those felony sexual assault charges pending, I think that that's the Senate ignoring the dictates of its own permanent rules on sexual harassment. So with that said, the intention here was to have this be brief, short, and effective. And I will leave it at that.
Okay, any response? Any questions?
I understand the intent. I guess maybe did you find that there were a contrary view that said that a suspension would be treated similar to expulsion? I've had Ledge Counsel do some research on this too, and yeah, anytime you have two attorneys or three attorneys, you're going to get two or three different rules or different opinions. But the memo I got indicated that this may be a suspension may be very similar to expulsion, requiring notice, due process, hearing on the proposed suspension, an opportunity to be present, that there had to be grounds for it, et cetera. And I wondered if you heard that.
If I could answer, my advice seeking on this was entirely from the Senate Secretary. So we had long, detailed conversations involving multiple sources and his conversations with California. And I will just stress again, I was persuaded that expulsion with the parallel proceedings you're talking about to the criminal case were potentially disruptive. So the reason I pursue this is because of that, because the advice from the Senate Secretary was very clear that we didn't need such hearings and that therefore that danger of stepping somehow inadvertently into the criminal case was not present with this resolution.
Then maybe, John, we could hear from Ledge Council to see if they believe that we are walking down a similar path with a suspension, that this might lead us to the same roadblocks that we considered in the expulsion, because
John, do you
that's mind? The information I had from Ledge Council.
Okay. If you want, I'm more than happy to, if Luke or Betsy Ann, whichever one, who would you like to have?
Either of them, they both worked on it, as did John. And I don't find it at all surprising that we have different views.
I didn't work on the memo.
No, you didn't work on the memo.
So,
Mr. Chair, do you wish us to?
Yeah, yes, I would. If the senator has a question, then I certainly would like it to be answered. And I apologize to the senators and that this is a longer than usual meeting. However, I think this is extremely important what we're doing here today, and I do not want to cut corners in any way for any of the parties involved.
I guess all I would ask, there's been talk that we're doing this suspension to avoid some of the potential pitfalls that we might face in an expulsion. And I'm just asking your opinion from your research whether we might be walking into the same series of pitfalls.
And just to be fair to both of you all sitting there, do you understand, I think, Senator Bloomer, what I was asking originally, because I have spoken, obviously, with the prosecutor who had mentioned that there was a concern if we did anything, and that's what that was based on. So if you have that clear, then if you can answer, then that's great.
We'll try to, once again, good afternoon, Marlin. And let me preface my response by saying that this puts us in a little bit of an awkward situation. We have tremendous respect for John Bloomer, who's the Secretary of the Senate, and this is his area of expertise. But if we are asked to opine on a matter by one of you who's our clients, we do that. I think that John has given a lot of great information, and we agree with almost everything he said. And as someone pointed out, there's no clear guidance. So this is an issue where smart, well-meaning people might disagree. Smart, well-meaning attorneys might disagree. So it doesn't mean that he's right or wrong, or we're wrong, or he's or the contrary. Betsy Ann Rask also spoke to California, and we don't dispute anything that John said. That is precedent. There's no court case that tells you what to do. That's absolutely correct. When we were looking at this and in our conversations with the individuals who've asked for our opinion, we approached it slightly differently, however. And we looked at, there's two options that have been put on the table. One is expulsion and one is suspension. And so in those conversations, we looked at what is the effect of either action, what are the grounds for either action, and as a result, would due process to some extent be required in either action. Now, if you start with expulsion, I realize that's not on the table, but if you start with expulsion, in expulsion, the senator is banned from carrying out his or her duties and expelled from the body. That is the effect of the action, and it would be permanent. The grounds for the action could be either the basis of the criminal charges, I think everyone agrees that that is probably not appropriate, or the impact upon the body, the media circus, or some other negative impact upon the rest of the body's ability to perform their duties. And I think everyone agrees that in the context of expulsion, some due process is required, such as notice and an opportunity to be heard. So if you turn out to suspension, what is the effect of this action? It's very similar. The senator is barred from carrying out his or her duty. Now, it may be temporary. That's a very good point. So that's a difference. But it could be 2 months or it could be the whole session. And so it is possible that the effect of this action is very, very similar. That the senator is barred from carrying out his or her duties for some period of time, perhaps most of or all of the session. What are the grounds for suspension? They're identical. It could be the nature of the criminal charges, which I think everyone agrees is not appropriate, or the impact upon the body. The exact same two grounds as under expulsion. And do we believe some form of due process may be required? Yes, we do. I don't know exactly what that due process would be. It doesn't have to be all the due process of a trial. But perhaps it could include some sort of notice, what is the basis to proceed, and some opportunity to be heard. So we think there's a good argument that some form of due process may be required.
And if I could just speak to that, and I don't preside over the Senate, and I don't dictate what the Senate does. It was my feeling that if this committee passed this forward to the Senate, that the Senate Secretary, from our discussions, that Senator McAllister would be given notice that a suspension hearing was, or a suspension motion was pending on the floor, and that if he was sitting that day, he would be allowed, as any other senator, to speak to it. Do I have that correct?
Yeah, I mean, yes. I mean, the short answer is I believe that there are some minimal amounts of due process you have to do. And I agree that if it's a permanent suspension, then you're to an expulsion.
Per se.
And so I just think that if you're proceeding with the suspension, the sooner you provide a copy of the resolution to the senator, the sooner you let the senator know the process that will be followed, like it's going to be introduced on Tuesday, put on the calendar for action the next day, the ability for that senator to come in and be on the floor and plead their case for why they shouldn't be suspended begins to meet some of those minimal requirements. I think that I look at the due process in this as what's really fair, and what's really, whether everybody agrees or doesn't agree, I think that what's minimally required to be fair is to have the senator have a chance to come in and speak and plead his case. And that then when, and I think that I'm pretty comfortable in that when I tell you that if you were going to suspend him for a day, I don't think you need any more than that. And so that's why I look at it potentially sort of similar, but a little different. I mean, it's where you get and how much due process you need, or fairness you need to include. And the way that this is currently worded with at least 2 months sort of frame, there's no definitive answer on this. But I think that if you give him notice, give him a right to come in, you've at least done enough that a court is going to give you some discretion. I can't give you that with a black or white 100% guarantee. And that is the practice of law nowadays in the 20th century.
Luke, can I ask, does that substantially match your feeling?
Yes, I have no disagreement with anything said. There is one other issue that I think suspension puts on the table that's different than expulsion, and that's the potential argument that could be raised that the constituents are being denied their equal representation. Mm-hmm. And of course, we never know if anyone would go to court, and there is an issue called the political question doctrine that courts are very reluctant to intrude on the legislative sphere. So there's many issues you've talked about today and many things you could do that courts will not adjudicate. However, the exception to that doctrine is if there's a constitutional issue. And it's arguable that there's a constitutional issue raised here because because those constituents will not have equal representation. And it could be for a short period of time, or it could be a little longer, but they're denied equal representation during that period. So there is a constitutional aspect to that claim, and if someone were to go to court, perhaps the courts might therefore adjudicate that claim.
Thank you.
Is there any way to deal with that issue?
As far as not if there's a constitutional issue out there, which I think there is in that case.
Right.
If there is no legitimate constitutional issue, it probably would be a factor.
As far as, I mean, the only replacement now would come if the that's what I'm talking about. As far as, and is there a cure to the, let's say, defect that might be created in the absence of a senator?
I do not believe the governor could appoint a replacement, or you could appoint a replacement if an individual is suspended. I am not sure about that. I would see if anyone else, but I do not know about that.
No, there's two words of using the word defect. So I'm not really sure. One of the defects would be I don't believe you can. The governor is the only one who can appoint, and there has to be a vacancy, and a suspension is not a vacancy. And similarly, there's no recall. The other definition of defect is, because there's not a senator on the floor, does that make a vote defective? No. In my opinion, that just when the senator's absent, not on the floor, you still have a certain quorum, you got to work out a 29. So there's two potential uses of that term. One is that would not affect the final vote of a floor vote. There is the issue on potentially the constitutional, using that as a
defect. Let me ask one other question further. Is there a definition of exact representation?
Yes.
You know what I'm saying? The fact is
that there must be two as opposed to one?
No, or the fact is, what is the representation? Does representation guarantee that that person is available to vote in a current section of a session of a biennium, as it been discussed? I imagine it's...
Well, this is a little different, so I know about that, but in this case, you're barring someone from having any opportunity to vote, so they can't perform their duties. It's a little different, I think, than someone who's safe.
Right, but my question is the voting itself, is that the crux of representation as defined in the Constitution?
For the record, Betsy Ann Rasko, Legislative Council. Thinking about it right now off the cuff, we know from the Constitution that we have to have equal representation. We have reapportionment case law that says that all citizens have an equal right to vote for legislators. What we don't have is the case law saying what happens after they are voted into office. And I think it's because we don't have case law on legislative suspensions. But I can't think of any language in our Constitution that discusses voting offhand right now.
Okay. All right, Joe. We've given our formal presentations on. There's two things pending in front of us right now.
Before we give our opinions,
I don't have any questions.
Okay. So, any more questions?
No.
Okay, Dick. All right. Thank you. Thank you very much. And I'm sorry to put you guys in the pickle there. And I think Senator Bloomer understands and recognizes the current situation. So,
John, yeah. I would just like to say on that, both of the Ledge Council and the Secretary Bloomer worked on this from the same angle, from different angles, and it isn't at all surprising that we have slightly different views because it's uncharted territory.
And also, just for the record, and I think all of us here know, is that they both and Betsy Ann have been working on this since the summer. So, that was fine.
And we really ought to thank them.
Yes. So at this time, Norm, I'm going to give you an opportunity if you'd like to come up and sit down. Again, I must urge you I spoke with you last night when we talked about the potential when you said that you might want to discuss or talk today. I advise you that I thought you should definitely run this by your counsel. And today I just want to make sure that you do not touch upon anything dealing with the case. And if you start to get into that area, I'm going to stop you, okay?
Well, thank you, John, for the time. This has been a horrendous thing on me personally through the year. I never intended to have this kind of showdown with anybody. As you know, I have said that I am not guilty of any of the charges, and I'm standing by that. So let's go on to this. I look at this proposal by Senator Burr as the same thing as expulsion. It's different wording. It does the same thing, and it doesn't allow me to represent the people who elected me. So let me tell you that this summer has been one of the worst summers, other than losing my wife, that I've ever gone through. I have had a lot of support from my constituents, my neighbors, family, all that. In fact, they're why I haven't quit, because they've been pushing me not to. I have had constituents tell me that they will bring a lawsuit if I'm not allowed to represent them, and if that's necessary. I would prefer it wasn't necessary. I have not, in my knowledge, broken any rules of the Senate, ethics or otherwise. And I have I took my constitutional oath extremely serious. I've taken it for 7 years, 7 times. And I have taken that extremely serious, and have done nothing to try to, you know, I tried staying within that whenever any discussions came up. So to have this happening at this level by my colleagues is quite disturbing. I don't believe any of my actions have ever shown that I have ever been a threat to anybody. And I've been in this building for 13 years. So, I don't know what the resolution is to finish. What you will have, that'll be up to you. I have not wanted to be in the limelight. I'm not a person that likes cameras or microphones, and I'm finding myself in a spot where I really am not comfortable and would rather not do it. But that said, this whole proceedings that have been brought on to me has financially ruined me. It's been very emotionally hard. It has sullied everything that I have ever done in my adult life. I have been, by some, misquoted, also been bullied, threatened by some of my colleagues, and we do have laws against that, but it's not going to pertain in this case. So I'm saying I should be afforded the same thing any other citizen of Vermont or United States is, and that's presumption of innocence until proven guilty. I have not done what I've been accused of. I've got a daughter and 4 granddaughters that I think the world of. That is not something that would be acceptable with any of them. So, moving forward, I understand you feel you have to do something, but it's kind of like, I see it as, well, you got somebody down on their knees, so kick them in the head. And that's the way I look at this proceeding. So, thank you.
Thanks. Next one. Okay. Peg, would you like to start?
Do I have an opinion?
No, I mean, would you, if you'd like to make a comment before we
No, I just would like to vote and then.
Would you like to take a break first?
No, let's vote.
Okay.
Joe? I'm going to start by saying I can appreciate circumstances that Senator McAllister is in, and I know that this proceeding is not easy. It is not easy for any of us. And as he knows, I have taken a position from the get-go that he should have resigned and let the court system play out. And his having chosen not to do that put me into a position where I felt, as far as my responsibilities are concerned, that action of some kind had to be taken. I've heard a whole lot of conflation here between criminal guilt or innocence versus whether the Senate has a responsibility and the authority to act. I would caution anyone to understand that the Senate has done everything it can to avoid having any impact whatsoever on a criminal proceeding now pending. And I don't want my words to be taken as having any kind of reference to that at all, except to note that they exist. Now, it seems to me we have a situation where, from his words as I've understood them, have given a difficult situation for us that we have to react to in some form. And the options are four. One is to do nothing, and I don't find that acceptable. Another is to expel, and in my eyes, that would provide the citizens of Franklin County, and in fact, my caucus, a full vote if he were replaced. I understand we don't have the votes for that, so I'm down to the two options that are now in front of us. Senator Flory, Senator Bruth, I want to commend you both for working overtime, trying to figure out solutions here that would make the most sense and be the least burdensome to anybody here. Senator Flory, I'm going to address your resolution first. A point was raised earlier about what this would technically do in the long term. Now, I'll use this example. If I was to stand up here now and pull Senator Bruth out of his chair and pummel him senseless on the floor, and then be charged tomorrow with a crime, and the charge was pending for aggravated assault, this resolution, as I understand it, would freeze the Senate's ability to police itself, at least freeze it, and turn that over to the court system to make a determination which would be taken into account by us if we reconvene that committee after, as I read this language, an appeal process was done if there was no entry of judgment pending appeal. I find that very troubling. I do not wish to cede the Senate's responsibilities and authority over to the court system. I think it is incumbent upon us as senators to police ourselves, and we have not only the authority to do that, but the responsibility to do that, even in the most uncomfortable of circumstances. I'll turn to Senator Bruth's resolution. I'm not 100% satisfied with it, because it does leave us in a situation where we have one vote less than we should, and I'm speaking about my caucus. The Senate also has one vote less than it should, and the concern that has been raised about potential intervention by the court system, I think, is a very valid one. I understand what we do has the potential for triggering a court response. I would like to avoid that at all costs, but I have no control over whether that happens or not. And I feel as if I am forced to vote for one of these two resolutions. It was brought up for discussion before that we could technically pass both of these. My observation of that is it would leave us looking like a circular firing squad presenting these two things to the Senate. because they are vehicles that are heading in completely the opposite direction. And if you pass them both, the Senate is in no better position than we are today, and we're the ones charged with having to come up with a solution to present to the Senate. So my default position, if you will, is to go along with Senator Bruce's resolution. I think if there is going to be a court challenge, whether it be on this resolution or any other, that the trick to minimizing your exposure is to minimize the design of what it is that the senator would be charged with. That may be an issue we have to play out down the road. If we pass this resolution, there is always the possibility it will become something else that we have to deal with at a later time. And it is obvious from the language of the resolution that we will anyway. And when that happens, it will again be incumbent upon us to try to avoid a triggering device in which the court system becomes involved. So to wrap it up, I'm going to vote in favor of Senator Bruce's resolution and against Senator Flores' resolution, but I want to thank you both again for taking the time to work overtime to try to resolve this. I especially want to thank John Bloomer, Luke, and Betsy Ann. I know that with respect to all three of you, I've been working with you since May on this issue, and I know how hard you have been working, and that is very much appreciated. We are all in uncharted waters, doing the best we can under circumstances that are not of our own bringing. So thank you, and that's where I'm planning to vote.
Bill?
I thank Senator Benning for his comments. To speak to one piece of what Senator McAllister said, one of the reasons why suspension became an attractive option for me is that it does not prejudge the issue or the innocence or guilt of the person suspended. In American life, in Vermont life, you typically, in many professions, but especially professions where people are entrusted with power over others, when charges are preferred, criminal charges, often those people are suspended pending the outcome. So I'm thinking here of policemen who are involved in shootings that are questioned, or teachers who are accused of improper conduct with their students. They are moved out of the classroom, moved off the beat while those charges are pending. It's not intended to prejudge the case, but it does say that in the tension between protecting public safety, or in this case, the safety of the chamber and the integrity of the chamber, we will err on the side of protecting those who have been entrusted to us. And again, I would say pages, ledge counsel, JFO, all of the people in the building who are in extremely deferential positions to senators. Now, if you are not a senator, if you're not a House member, you don't see this as often as we do. But when we move through the building, people are helping us, serving us, staffing us, and it's a huge responsibility. If there's a question, a substantial question, felony question, about whether that power has been abused and abused with someone in the role of a state house intern, I believe absolutely the course of action is to suspend that person pending the outcome. Now, the only other thing I'll say is that we have two resolutions here. I think Secretary Bloomer is correct. Technically, we could pass both. Technically, we could work out all sorts of calisthenics and gymnastics on the floor procedurally to make the two somehow both take effect. But they are fatally at odds with one another, and I would hope no one can miss that distinction. One is saying that the Senate should be prevented from acting in this particular case, among others. The other is not just saying that the Senate can act, but that we must act. And so I will be voting to approve, obviously, the resolution I put forward, but with respect for my colleague, Senator Flory, who is, just let me say, a phenomenal senator, I will be voting against her resolution.
Okay.
You know my positions, I guess. I'm just going to point out two things that were just said by the two previous speakers, talking about employees in a school suspended. He's absolutely correct. We do that in police departments and school because they're employees. We have that ability for employees. Elected officials have a different responsibilities. We're held to perhaps a higher standard, but there is a real difference in suspending someone who you hire versus suspending someone who the voters elected. That's number one. Number two, to Senator Benning, who indicated that my resolution would stop us from taking action if he pounded Senator Baruth. I assume he means out of our presence, and he's absolutely right, because I would want to make sure it wasn't exactly the opposite, that Senator Baruth pounded Senator Benning, and I'd want the court to figure that out. I still feel that a suspension carries some due process problems, but particularly denies Franklin County of part of their constitutional right. I think for me to vote to do that, I'm knowingly breaking my oath of office to not do anything that affects their constitutional right. And for me, the presumption of innocence for anyone is so strong, should be so strong, that I don't think we should do it. And my resolution, I hope we are treating it, and I should make sure that it does in fact say felony, not just crimes.
I amended the one I wanted.
Yes, thank you. I support that because I think it's time we set up a process before we ever, ever, ever have to go through a summer and fall like we've all been through.
Dick?
I've given this a lot of thought over the summer. I am not going to support either resolution, and I will give you just a short reason for both. I think one of them, the committee process from Senator Flory, bothers me. It still assumes that the person is guilty. I think if it's going to come up in February, that's a short time away, I think we probably should wait and find out either guilt or innocence in the case. The only thing that I know a lot about this case from what I've read in the press, I feel I am not qualified to make a decision whether the senator is guilty or innocent, just what I've read. To do this, I feel it would jeopardize the case. The other suspension means somewhat of guilt, and I don't want to leave here today assuming that I know that the person is guilty or innocent at this time. I think they both deserve certainly some discussion, but at this point, I don't feel qualified to make that decision, knowing that the voters of Franklin County elected this person. It is not like, I think Senator Flory stated, it's not like an employee. This person was elected by the constituents back in the county, and I just don't want to be the one that changes the court case at all, assuming innocence or guilt. I would be much more comfortable come February, if that's when the case is coming up in a very short few weeks, telling us the outcome. So at this time, I am not prepared to vote for either one. Thank you.
Okay. As a lawyer, I guess I'm looking at this through the eyes of Lady Justice. And while I can say that I would fight until my last breath is taken to defend one's constitutional right to the presumption of innocence until proven guilty, I have to look at this from the Senate and from the institution here in the legislature. And my concern is that this issue has caused a tremendous uproar within not only the legislative community, but also within the state. It concerns me that when we return, if Norm is, if you're seated under this cloud that is there, which none of us can sit there and try to make it, no matter what way we say it from defense side or the other side, or accusatory side, there's no getting away from that cloud that's there at this current time. So what happens with that cloud? There are people here, or there are people that feel very, very strongly that you should not see it sit in the Senate seat again. There are those, as you mentioned earlier, that believe you have a right to be there, you should be there, you have that right to be sitting there until a court finds you guilty of crimes, if they do. But as I said earlier, I think we sometimes mix up, as Senator Benning said, conflate the issues of a criminal action versus this, what I'll call administrative action. And we, while there is definitely that presumption of innocence and you should not give up anything, any right prior to being, if you are found guilty. However, while sitting in the Senate, I think it is a privilege for all 30 of us. It's a privilege to sit in the entire legislative body for the other 150 in the House. And I believe that the institution, this legislative institution that we have, is so important not just to us who sit here, but also to every man, woman, and especially kids, children, that they see it as something that is special and untainted. And regardless of whatever the outcome is of this, I think we all can agree that there has been that air of something amiss here. And so it's my belief that we should not be faced, and I don't think you should be faced also, I want to touch on that for a second, is with what may occur or the atmosphere that might envelop this legislative body, this state house, if you are seated while the trial is pending. I don't think it's going to be healthy for anyone. That's not just the Senate or not just the House, or because it's not just us, it's the entire legislative body. But as I've said, I'm also concerned about what it would be like, the atmosphere that you would be subjected to as well. And I just can't help to think that with pressures that are brought to bear on people, sometimes they can end up with terrible, terrible consequences, ones that were not ever anticipated, and ones that could have people acting in ways that they would not act before. And I see this also for potential of people, as I said, acting in ways they wouldn't, in a very ugly fashion. And I just feel that for the sake of the legislative body and for all of the people that are concerned right now, that I would have to support the suspension resolution. And I cannot support yours, Peg, because I believe it does create some unintended consequences. I guess my greatest hope is that whatever is to occur does so quickly, and so that people can know and have some certainty and some understanding as to what is, what the next step will be. So, John, if you want to do an official
I've been keeping track, but I will do each separately now.
Yes.
But my understanding is the process is you want to do Senator Flores first.
Yes.
Senator Benning?
No.
Senator Baruth?
No.
Senator Mazza?
No.
Senator Flory?
Yes.
Senator Campbell?
No.
Senator Baruth's motion for suspension of proposed resolution. Senator Benning?
Yes.
Senator Baruth?
Yes.
Senator Mazza?
No.
Senator Flory?
No.
Senator Campbell?
Yes.
I have the Baruth motion as a committee resolution 3-2, and at this point I have the Flory proposal resolution, not a committee resolution, 1-4.
I would ask that we now, as far as what the procedure is from here, John, so we have it clear from your vantage point.
There are two components, Mr. Chair, Senator. One of them is my recommendation to you would be to have the resolution sort of put in format as soon as possible. Although Senator McAllister is here today, I believe that you should
ask that you send him a copy directly.
As soon as possible, with somewhat of what the procedure may be, and that's sort of the second issue. There are three things that can be done with a resolution. They can be read and adopted, they can be referred to a committee, and they can be read the first time, placed on the calendar for action the next day. We've been researching this one more recently. Generally, the preferred method, and I'll give you the sort of the reasons afterward, I believe is to read it on the first day of the session, have it introduced, and take action the following day. And that's really a fairness due process issue, but it's also, I think you may have the power to do it in the same day if you were wanting to be as safe as possible. Once again, getting back to sort of the challenging, you should probably do a rule suspension, but I meant, under all the circumstances, my recommendation to you would be to follow sort of the standard path, which would be to have it read the first day, placed on the calendar for action the next day. And that would be what I would include in a letter to Senator McAllister, which would be that it would be the intent to introduce it on Tuesday, have it up for action on Wednesday. For the senators, the current schedule, my understanding is we meet on Tuesday, and then Wednesday would be a 1 o'clock session unless you decide to change that, something different, but our standard on that Wednesday would be 1 o'clock.
Okay, so I would ask on behalf of the committee that the letter be presented, sent to Senator McAllister, and make sure that includes all of your colloquy that you just had, and that Senator McAllister, if he has any questions, be provided with the opportunity to contact you or ledge counsel to ask for any clarity.
John, can I just ask a question? Should Senator McAllister appear and want to argue from the floor, is he subject to potential interrogation?
I would think there are some limited exceptions. My once again, there's everything that's different, preferred, what can be done or not be done. My preferred would be that the proposer of the resolution can be interrogated. It's required by our rules. And so someone will have to report on behalf of the rules committee. I'm assuming at this point that's going to be Senator Baruth, but we just need to know before we actually have that Wednesday. Generally speaking, senators are entitled to speak subject to our rules, which including Senator McAllister. It would be my first inclination to say no, because he's not the presenter, and I don't think that there'd be lots of potential technical violations of other rules, and so the best process would be no, that he should not be interrogated.
Are we sending this document that he's getting and copying everyone else in the Senate? Because if we are, and I would suggest that we do, that that statement be included, that should Senator McAllister choose to speak, that he is not subject to interrogation.
And that would, and, or, and if it, that's also the recommendation of the Rules Committee, as long as everybody else agrees with that, but I think that that would be the recommendation, that he is not subject to any interrogation.
I will send it to all, I will probably use email, except for the couple senators who don't use email, but I send it to them other ones, up by other ones.
Okay, if there's any other further business, seeing none, I will declare this meeting closed. Thank you.